Starting off today's mailbag by pouring out a pint of Mountjoy Dry Irish Stout from Stone Angel Brewing in Winnipeg. They describe it as a traditional dark, roasty, and dry stout with notes of coffee and chocolate, very much in the Irish style. They've chosen to name this one after the Mountjoy Brewery in Dublin, or used to be in Dublin. It was opened in 1852 and closed in 1957. Very nice indeed. So the first item in the mailbag is integrated circuit. Is my scalpel dull? Oh no, just got to press harder. And, you know, cut in the right spot. Gee, it's been long enough. I'm out of practice at this. These are surface mount 8-pin ICs. Okay, time to get up the magnifier and see what they are. They're ATtiny 45. If I remember correctly, last time I got ATtiny 85, so these are just a slightly lower powered, and I'm assuming lower price alternative to the in the ATtiny lineup. 10 pieces ATtiny 45-20SU 8-bit microcontroller, Tiny 45-20SU new. Got these from Alan Liu 1995. And I paid $19.28 Canadian. And yeah, I did take a look, and this 10-pack was about $5 cheaper than the 10-pack of ATtiny 85s that I got a little while ago. So the ATtiny 85 looks like it's got twice as much SRAM and twice as much EEPROM space as the 45. They're both 8-pin DIPs with 6 GPIO pins available. Other than that, they're almost the same. So the only real difference is the amount of memory that they have. Next in, we have screw times one. I don't suppose they sent just a single screw in a bag. No, it's a bunch of surface mount components. This is a package of 33 different resistances, 20 pieces each of 1206 surface mount resistors. 1206 being the physical size of the thing. And 1206 is the largest of the common sizes of surface mount resistors, which makes it easy for somebody with my big fumbly hands and aging eyes to work with. Now, I've already got a few different sizes of resistors for doing repairs and kits and stuff like that. But if I'm going to design my own stuff, which I may or may not, I would like to use the larger ones just because, you know, I'm old. 660 pieces, 1206 SMD resistor assortment kit, 1 ohm to 1 mega ohm, 1%, 33 values times 20 pieces DIY set. So these cost $5.83 Canadian with 56 cents shipping, so a little bit over $6. Not too bad given today's prices for everything. Not too much to say about them that hasn't already been said. The values go from 1 ohm all the way up to 1 meg in fairly standard steps. I think that'll be a handy little assortment pack just to have in stock in the shop. Next thing in does not say what it is. It seems to have come from a Canadian reshipping warehouse. So mysteries upon mysteries. Oh, a couple of things. Oh, hey, actual Creality branded 3D printer fans. And in the last mailbag, I also got a set of fans, but they were third-party knockoffs. These ones are the real thing. And they are both 24 volts, because that's what my printer wants, and they are the right size this time. This one is a standard fan, and this one is the little squirrel cage blower one that blows out the side. We had this discussion a couple weeks ago. I don't think I need to rehash it. But now I have spare parts for when, not if, but when, the fans on my printer die. Lots of spare parts. I figured while I was ordering, I might as well order from a couple of different sources and see if I can get a couple of different brands just to try out. Why not, right? Creality 3D 40x40x10mm 24-volt high-speed DC brushless 4010 nozzle cooling fan for 3D printer Ender 3. An official Creality 3D product. This cost me $6.49 Canadian with, you know, 33 cents shipping. A little bit more expensive than the other knockoff ones, but I don't think that's a major concern. It's not a huge amount different, really. And the other fan
Creality 3D 4010 blower fan, 24 volts, 6800 revs per minute, length 1400 millimeters with 2.5 terminals. That would be the wire length. Cooling fan for Ender 3 V2 3D printer, which is exactly what I've got. Also $6.49. This one was free shipping. This is the part cooling fan. It's the squirrel cagey fan that takes air in that side and blows it out the edge to cool the part on the bed. Other vendors are selling the same thing for a few dollars more. So as always, shop around and save.
Well, so far it's all been fairly standard items. Let's see what this one is. It says LED beads LED. Okay. Maybe these will be more interesting. I do like a good LED. Interesting. Bubble wrap wrapped around bubble wrap. Ooh, these are larger LEDs. Okay. Ooh, these are much larger LEDs. That's cool. And they are 4-pin, which means they are some sort of RGB LED. Looks like these are 8mm LEDs. Okay. Just for reference, 3mm, 5mm, and 8mm LEDs. They look like they might be standard LEDs, not smart LEDs. They're not addressable.
100 pieces WS2811 APA106 P9823 F5 5mm F8 8mm round RGB LED chipset full color. Okay, so they are addressable LEDs. I was mistaken. This seller has a bunch of different ones, but I got the WS2811 F8 version. And these cost me $23.13 with free shipping for the 100 of them. So 23 cents each. Okay, that's a little bit expensive, but I think they're fairly unique LEDs. So part number WS2811 F8, full RGB 24-bit. Runs off the WS2811 chipset, 5 volts, 120 milliamps, 40 milliamps per chip. Okay, that's a little bit more than an average LED. 100 to 120 degree viewing angle, 8 millimeters, which is the part that attracted my attention. So useful information down here. It's got pinouts for the various different ones in the listing. On this type, ground is the long pin. That one grounds the long pin. Looks like ground is the long pin on all of these different types. Okay, so let's hook one up on a breadboard and see what happens.
So these do act just like any standard addressable LED. I've got my data coming from the Arduino Nano. In this case, I'm using Fast LED. You could use Adafruit's library as well, or any other library if you want. But in this case, it is Fast LED, and I've got it set to WS2811 settings. So data is coming out of pin 6 into the end pin on this guy, that one being the data input. The second pin over from that is ground. The third one is positive voltage, which is different from what it showed in all those drawings. In this case, we have ground and positive. All those drawings showed the longest one as positive, as negative voltage. So are these factory seconds, or are they just different and the listing didn't show the right pinouts? But I've made a sticker for the bag showing where the positive voltage is so that I don't forget and waste time the next time I go to play with these things. Still, they're really cool. They're huge RGB LEDs. Gotta like that. And now, the last and largest package in today's mailbag, this one. It doesn't even fit on my workbench. It feels like there's two separate boxes inside this, so I'll kind of open it up so that I can separate those two apart. Yeah, it is. You can see that? Okay, I'll slice this open quickly and we'll see what's in there. All right, we have two cardboard boxes, one of which did not get treated gently in shipping. I hope the contents are okay. So open up the mangled one first and hope for the best. Huh, nice little cloth bag. Well, plasticky cloth bag. whatever. I think I know what it is because I don't think I ordered anything else that huge, but we shall see. That's looking very tripod-y. It's looking like what I think it is. There is, did not expect a GoPro style mount. Okay. So that is definitely a tripod stand. Couple of extension bits. Cool. And in here we have an LED cable and, aha, that's what I thought it was. It is an LED light panel, a photography light panel. USB powered with a little, so just a push on, push off. Okay. I'm assuming the other one is another one of these because I'm pretty sure I ordered a pair of them. Just plug this guy into a USB power source off to the side here. Oh, hey, that's bright. Cool. I think that will, obviously intended as photography lighting. Remember these little newer lights? I've got a pair of them hanging just off to the sides here. Kind of like that, just sort of as fill lights. And I'm thinking that these big guys can replace those. Or with the stands, be able to be used in various different places, like when I'm over at the 3D printer or in other places in my workshop area, so I don't have to use as janky a lighting anymore. But anyways, I'm going to turn off those two little fill lights. I think you can see the difference there. And then I will hold this guy right under the camera. Oh yeah, it does make a difference. I think it... Let me turn the little tiny fill lights back on again. Can it even overpower them? Yeah, you can definitely notice it. So the top of this stand has a couple of fittings. This sort of divoted in piece is a standard sort of C-stand lighting thing, although it's lightweight stamped metal, so it's not that sturdy. But then underneath that is a quarter 20. Which all standard camera stuff, and this little GoPro style mount clamps on too quite nicely. And then that just goes onto there. Which way would I want to put it? I think I'll put it this way, just because, nope, it goes better that way. Okay, I'll put it the way it wants to go then. And then just screw it back down, and you've got your light mounted. Cool. 84 LEDs, 1680 lumens, 1.8 meter height adjustable LED camping light with tripod, 6500 to 7000 Kelvin brightness, not really, that's not a brightness measurement, that's a color temperature measurement. Where was I? Oh yeah, stand lantern work light for camping, maintained photography. The pair of them cost me $32 Canadian, $32.13 with 43 cents shipping. The specs, 84 LEDs, we knew that. 5 volts, 1 to 2 amps, mobile power, USB, charger, computer, all can be powered. No, I wouldn't use something that draws a full amp plugged into my computer's USB. Sorry, nope. 18 watts max, 50,000 hours, yeah. IP65, so not completely waterproof, but also not going to explode in the rain. The metal bracket, aka stand, is 1.8 meters shrinkable. Material, iron. No, it's not. It's just cheap stamped aluminum, maybe steel. Fireproof plastic, maybe. I don't know. 1680 lumens, sure. They keep saying it's suitable for camping and beach and outdoor dinner. Not really a photography light, maybe, but it kind of looks like one. I don't know. I'm going to use it for photography anyway. My cameras have all got auto white balance, so it should be able to deal with it. Okay, here we are over in the corner where some of the railroad stuff is. And I'm just going to turn on the two lights. There's one. And there is the second one. I think that makes a significant difference, and it's fairly decent light considering that it's just nice and generic. So I think that's pretty cool. It's going to be useful. There's one of them sitting up there. There is the other one. This one's just running off battery, so it's a little bit lower voltage and it's dropping pretty quickly, but it is drawing the 1 amp that it said it was going to. So I think all in all, that's a pretty good purchase. It's going to be handy for when I'm doing photography and videography away from my workbench. And there is the contents of today's Mailbag Monday haul. Quite the variety. Shipping times, the longest was these LEDs, took 74 days. The fastest was these lights and stands, which took 21 days. Everything else came in the mid to high 20s of days. So that's not too bad, except for these guys. And I am a little disappointed that the data sheets in the listing for these things had the wrong pinouts, but it wasn't that hard to figure out just by trial and error. So I think I discussed what I'm going to use these things all for. The fans are spare parts. The resistors are just shop stock. These AT Tiny chips are going to be interesting to play with if I need a low power and cheap microcontroller. They're big LEDs. What's not to like? And these things, they're not super rugged or heavy duty. They're relatively bright for what they are. Basically for, about $15, $16 for each, right? $32 for the set of them. That's not bad just for the lights themselves. These stands are lightweight and fairly flimsy, but if you just are gentle with them, they'll be okay for what they are. You can put just about anything on them. It needs a 1/4-20, which is kind of handy. They kept harping on them being camping lights or outdoor lights. I don't know that I would trust them to be durable in that kind of a situation. For indoors, for just kicking around my shop here, for doing a bit of video lighting, I think they'll be just fine, especially at the cheap price. Well, thanks everybody for stopping by and watching. Thanks as always to my Patreon supporters and my channel members who kick in a buck or two into the tip jar every month. I do appreciate that. That helps keep the mailbags rolling in and, equally importantly, keeping the beer fridge full. Questions and comments down below as usual. Thanks for watching. I'll talk to you later.